raps like I'm in shape.
Ball of by Talknutt!
Make shots on shots like there's no takes. I'ma shine on them all like there's no shake.
There's the man. Oh boy, are you tired, bro?
Feeling like it's game time. Game time. Suit up. It's game time.
And now, the Ron Talknutt Podcast.
And welcome back, Nutt-Heads, to the sixth. I do this every single time. You would think one of these times I'm going to figure out what episode we're on.
Way to prepare.
So here's what I'm going to do. I'm just going to say, welcome to the sixth episode. Welcome to the seventh episode, Nutt-Heads. Hey, Nutt-Heads, we're glad you're back for our eighth episode. And Megan can edit whatever one of those is correct.
Nice. I like that.
Yeah. I'm just going to start doing that from now on. But as usual,
episode five before.
As usual, we're your hosts, Brian, Mike, and Christian. Guys, say hi.
What up, what up?
Hey, guys.
And we got something special for you today. We've got Kevin, who's going to hop on the podcast in a little bit. He's been looking to get on, kind of defend himself. I know we've been critical of some of his moves, so that conversation coming to you in a little bit. But first off, we did some thinking, and, you know, who wants to hear us talk? The answer is like two people, by the way.
Yeah, I love hearing myself talk.
We decided we want the Nutt-Heads to drive the conversation for this episode. So we put out a call for questions, a mailbag episode, if you will. And the response was overwhelming. Guys, we got 9 questions to talk about today.
Really?
We got nine questions.
That's better than I would have thought.
So
how many submitters?
4.
Wow, that's like... When you take away us three, we didn't get to mail them in, did we?
No. If you think of a question, though, you can ask, but that is not.
If you take out us three and then 4 more people participated, that's like.
That's over half.
And I assume Megan didn't do one.
She did.
Oh. Okay.
So.
Well, we're about 50%.
Yes. First off, anything you guys want to talk about before we get into the mailbag? There hasn't been much going on in the league. Transaction-wise,
I think the only interesting thing is just how it just seems like this week all the COVID cancellations and protocols have kind of come back in the NHL after I feel like a few weeks of having pretty low activity that end. But that's about it, really, the last couple of weeks.
Yeah, so kind of in the lulls of the season a little bit as teams gear up for the playoffs. We only got 2 weeks after this of the regular season, so
holy crap, that's so crazy.
it's coming to a close quickly. So, all right, we'll jump into the mailbag then. We'll start off, we mentioned Kevin's coming on the podcast. We'll start off with one of his questions. And this one's directed at Mike Rooney. So, question from Kevin F. He said, what's wrong with the Blackhawks? Or is this more who they are? So, I'll let you handle that one first, Mike.
I am so torn about the Blackhawks because I obviously at the beginning of the season, I thought they were awful. I thought they were kind of performing how they would right now. And then they had this stretch of like, I don't know, 15, 20 games where I thought they were legitimately a playoff contending, could win a series type of team. And not just because they were winning games, but because they were outplaying teams and like outshooting them. And they had Lankinen back in there who was like, you know, having a reasonable save percentage compared to like the other goalies that they had at the beginning of the season. And like the second line started scoring, all the pieces were coming together. The young guys that they had were like performing and being able to shut down. Like it all felt good. And then it was like a flip of switch, maybe like 2 weeks ago, all of a sudden, like even against not good teams, they were getting outshot, didn't look good. So I totally see what he's saying. I'm guessing it's probably somewhere in the middle is my perspective. I think my expectations were probably too low coming in. And then they were probably getting lucky there for a while and things were just like going the right way. This is probably somewhere closer to the middle. I have a feeling they're kind of, the standings are pretty reflective of what kind of team they are. I think they're bubble team kind of fighting with Dallas and Columbus to get in. I thought they're for a hot second, I thought they were like going to be a shoe-in for the playoffs, but I don't think that's the case anymore. So I don't know. I think this is kind of the new, really where they should be performing based on their talent and roster. I don't know. What do you guys think?
Well, from afar, it seems like it's probably some growing pains too. They have a lot of young guys that they're trying to get in there. You know, Boquist, I think, what's his face? Kirby Dach just had his debut the other night. A lot of young guys up there. I mean, Lankinen is still a rookie. And on top of that, I mean, it's hard to fault a team. I mean, didn't they have like a stretch of like six or seven games like against the Panthers, like, and they lost like all of them. Like the Panthers are just good. I mean, I think the Panthers are maybe what the Blackhawks want to be in a couple of years. But like, I think part of it's growing pains. I mean, I think Patrick Kane can only do so much, you know, as like and Duncan Keith are like the two veterans on that group. And when you have a lot of young guys, when you have, God, who's centering Canes? It's a Pius. What's his last name? Pius Suter. Like you have like a bunch of guys like that. A lot of David Kampf. Like, you know, like, look, it's gonna be, you know, rough waters. And so I think they're still gonna be. I mean, they're what, still fourth in their division, right? They're still in a playoff seed, right?
As of now, yes, they're 2 points up on Nashville.
Yeah. So
spot.
And they play Nashville today, so today will be pretty big.
Yeah.
So I kind of agree and kind of disagree. I think the growing pains are real for sure. Like you said, they have an entirely new roster from, you know, 3 years ago.
Yeah.
But I think that phase is already almost finished. Like some of these guys are, like, I think they're building an identity and it's like they're kind of performing at what the expectations are. Like Suter has looked really good and like he's fitting in with that line well, and like, to have some depth with the Kubalik line. Like he honestly looks really good. I think having a full season under his belt last year, like Boquist looks good. All these guys I think are young and obviously not as good as they're going to be in a couple of years. But I almost think that initial, like getting into the league, like being able to compete at a new level is kind of there. And we're kind of just like building a new baseline. I think one of the worst parts about it is like having Kane and Duncan Keith, like they're not going to be an elite team with those guys on the team anymore. I don't think. I think like with the Brinkett is kind of where they need to. The Brinkett, like Kubalik, Boquist, Doc, that's going to be the new identity. And when they can get, you know, a deep roster built around those guys, that's when it's going to be a back to the Blackhawks of like the 2010 time.
Yeah, and it's kind of weird, a tough situation with Blackhawks because, like, you're right. They probably need to be moving away from, you know, the core of Kane, Taves and Keith, but there's just so much financial commitment there that you're like, you know, you're like, we got to play them, or in the whole, we need that leadership in the locker room. We need them there, you know? And so it's always such a weird position for, especially a team like what's that?
We just need fans. That's what it is. I mean, you can't, if you're the Blackhawks, you can't not, they're going to play them until they're dead or until they're out of the league, which is fine. I understand, but for winning, it's going to put a limit on how good they're going to be.
Yeah. And that's almost, I think, one of the best ways to put it. Someone mentioned this, when Kobe Bryant's like last couple of years, it's like the Kobe tax, like towards the end of their career, you pay that high salary for what they did for the franchise. And I mean, they brought three cups to the city. So it's going to be a tax essentially for Chicago. Just have to pay out that salary, play them. And like, look, we got you three cups. Like this is the tax you pay.
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree.
I would be a little cautious going into next year. I think in general, this is probably where they are, but I think you could see a little step back next year. Unless Kevin Lankinen actually is a .934 save percentage at even strength fully. So I think there's a lot of promise, a lot more promise than there was going into the season. And I think maybe some of the biggest question marks, because a lot of people were picking them last because, oh, they're going into the season with Colin Delia and Malcolm Subban in goal. So if Kevin Lankinen can even be like an average to above average goalie, they're going to be on the playoff bubble. And like you said, Mike, I think a lot of these young guys have provided a lot of hope for the future. I do still think it might be a year or two away, though.
Yeah. DeBrincat is going to be a really good player.
Yes.
He is.
He's
really good. He's one of those – he's like – I don't know. The Blackhawks seem to find those kind of players, like the Canes, Panarins, and DeBrincat. They all play, like, a similar style.
Yeah. Well, DeBrincat kind of changed the way – I think a lot of teams view the draft, because he was like the straw that broke the camel's back of like, oh, you can't draft small players. Like, if a guy's short, he's not going to succeed in the NHL. And you saw a couple of those guys, like Tyler Johnson had some success, and then DeBrincat had success. And part of that, too, was how good is he actually, because he was playing with McDavid and juniors. But there's a lot of guys who are going to owe some paychecks to DeBrincat, because I feel like he's the guy who's actually broken through as a short guy who can score.
Well, it's kind of funny you mentioned that. It's fitting that he's, you know, playing with Kane, because Kane was, you know, a small guy who kind of broke the mold as far as like you can pick a guy like that first overall, because he's so skilled. And you see, like, for example, Jack Hughes being picked first overall is not exactly the biggest guys. And so it's kind of fitting that DeBrincat and Kane are on the same team, because they kind of, you know, are in a sense pioneers in the same way.
Yeah. In a few years when Cole Caulfield's in the league, he got 10th overall. He owes a lot of money to Alex DeBrincat, I think. All right. Well, that was a good Blackhawks discussion. We'll move on to the next question. This one has got some international postage on it, coming in from Jack T from the Netherlands. He said, is Alexis Lafreniere actually not good? I know he's been kind of bouncing around on Jack's team a little bit, not as good for fantasy as maybe you would have hoped. What are your thoughts on him this year and into the future?
I don't really have like the underlying numbers. I do know the counting stats aren't there, but wasn't that the case with Kako Kako last year? And even this year, Kako hasn't put up the counting stats, but his like underlying numbers have apparently been very, very good. Mm-hmm. I think it's probably a combination of just, I mean, being a young guy, he's 18. I think that's one thing people need to remember. These rookies are 18, 19. Like it's, and they're playing against grown men. They're playing kids all their lives. They're learning that they can't do certain things, that their time and space are just, you know, not anywhere close to what they were in juniors. Without having seen too many Rangers games, admittedly, it seems to me it's like, yeah, let's give him a year or two. And maybe it's just the Rangers system. Cause I remember thinking like Kako is going to be super, super good. And that's why I kind of reached for him last year. And just didn't do anything. And I think it might be something with the Rangers system. I also feel like the Rangers offense is kind of struggling. It wasn't until recently, like Mika Zibanejad, for instance, got really going after like a really breakout year this year. So those are just kind of my knee-jerk reaction thoughts without having a subscription to whatever streaming platform to watch all the Rangers games.
Yeah, I haven't watched. I don't know if Ryan's watched many games. I haven't watched. I don't know, maybe one or two Rangers games total. So I don't know what he looks like watching him play. I do think that this happens like pretty consistently though every year, where we'll take a gamble on like a rookie that, you know, probably is really talented, but I don't remember a time when a rookie has come out and had like a really good season, even of the best players. Like maybe what was McDavid's rookie season? I bet this is probably the only one that was like,
he's still at like more than a point per game. He was at like, it was something like 40 some points in like 38 games, something like that.
Yeah. So his is a different story. I think he's like an anomaly, but the rest of them, like I know McKinnon, who I mean is obviously a stud now, like even in his rookie year I think he was maybe, I don't know, 45 points, 50
McKinnon's
points.
He took a few years.
McKinnon's first like 4 years he wasn't back like productive.
Yeah. And now it's an absolute freak. And like I know Sagan's rookie year was better than his, he had the sophomore slump, but he still wasn't an amazing, you know, wasn't anywhere near his career potential. And so I think all these guys, like in fantasy, we get kind of under their spell of the fact that they've got a big name and a lot of hype, and it's easy to take a gamble on them. But I just think it's so hard unless they're like the best players in the world, like Connor McDavid, that come around every 5, 6, 10 years.
Yeah.
But even Austin Matthews, like, so he had a sick
rookie. He had like 30 goals his rookie year.
No, but maybe 60 points. And I think he kind of got a little lucky because his first game he scored 4 goals.
Yeah.
So like, he got like there's some luck involved there, but he's still not anywhere near what he is a couple years later. You know what I mean? So like, I just think it's a huge growth in that first set, and it's like the expectations, at least for me, I need to like lower them a little bit for these super talented guys that are just going in.
Yeah,
and I think people want to compare Lafreniere to Kaprizov, because Kaprizov is having a great rookie year, but Kaprizov is 20 something years old. He's been a Russian pro for a number of years, so he's been against grown men for like 3 or 4 years or however long he's in the KHL. And also, I just think defense and goalies are better. I mean, I think in the early 2000s, we had like Ovechkin and Crosby going 100 points in their rookie years. And they're different beasts. I mean, they're Hall of Famers. But there was also like defense and goaltending was not what it is now. And I just think that you have much better athletes in both, you know, goaltending and defense, and just better strategy, better coaching overall, even in the last like 10, 15 years.
Yeah. And you got to remember the teams that are drafting first overall are generally not very good. I know Alexis Lafreniere's like bounced around on a couple lines, but according to Daily Faceoff, he's now playing with Philip Hedl and Julian Gauthier. So like,
superstar.
Yeah, they're not going to be put in good positions to succeed for fantasy. So I agree. I think the takeaway from Lafreniere is, I think he still can be very good. I think he still probably will be very good. But for fantasy, maybe just take a swing in the later rounds in the draft, and then don't be afraid to drop them after a week, because it's hard for them to contribute right away.
Well, Brian, have you watched any Rangers games?
I have not watched very many now. So,
I mean, even how many minutes is he getting? Is he even getting ice time?
Let's see. He's probably getting like 13, 14 minutes a game,
which you can't be relevant with that. But even like, so Kaprizov, I think, is like you said, the best quote unquote rookie, kind of by a significant margin in terms of offense. And he's only got 27 points.
Yeah.
Which, like,
he's just making the highlight reel a lot. So yeah, it feels like he's doing so.
But like, he's not really having that good of a season. You know what I mean? Yeah. And that's the best rookie that there is out there. So, like, if you hit the jackpot this year in rookies, you've got a player that's a borderline fantasy starter.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, just under a point per game.
Yeah. So yeah. I haven't checked. I don't know if Jack still has Lafreniere on his team.
I think he does.
I would. Yeah, I would drop him.
Drop him. Yeah. All right. Well, thanks for that question, Jack. We also got another question from Jack. Put it in the same envelope. So
Amsterdam. More questions for
me. He literally mailed it to you?
No, he did not. That was a
good one. I'm going to pretend that he did.
If he mails it to you, we should just give him the tug nut. Like, we should just give him the trophy if he mailed that to you.
So Jack is asking us to dig back into the record, or not the record books, but the history a little bit. He asked, what do you think is the best fantasy team name in league history?
I mean, we love Taro Tsujimoto's just because of how, like, what a deep cut that is.
And Steve-O's explanation of, he's a fantasy. He's not a real person. He's a fantasy player for a fantasy hockey league.
That might be the winner, right? Like,
that's the one that immediately comes to mind. So I know you guys are going in cold, so I'll let you think a little bit. But I went back through the years just to try to find a couple good ones.
Please tell me two girls, one Stanley Cup is in there.
Here's a few that caught my eye. That are worthy of recognition, I think. Two Girls, One Stanley Cup is not one of them.
thank you.
I think going back to 2012, Dominic Bertolini, fresh off his first and only fantasy win, his name was Don't Take My Tug Nut. I appreciated that one.
Yeah.
See, going into 2013, Toot It and Boot It. Good name for Jack.
I do think that Jack has the best names year after year.
There's one that does come to mind. There's one that comes to mind. I think it was Isaac's. It was after Scott Housen got fired, because he was Firehousen, and then the next year was Firehousen.
That was another one I could bring up.
Yeah. That might be my favorite, actually.
That's a good consistency. I got to give credit to Dave. Great Pucky Handling is a good player pun name. But – and then one more. Three more. Okay. The stage 5, 6, 7 clingers, just because of the progression year to year, was pretty good. The year Dave drafted Bakanji Amama, and he was the Bahama Amamas.
Dave is pretty good at the names.
Dave's not winning many tug nuts, but he's winning the names. Like
the Bahama Amamas might be it for me. But I'd be remiss if I didn't bring up the year that John Stout was in the league and his team name was John.
I forgot John was in the league. Yeah. That's just the most odd brand name, like John. Yeah.
If you know John Stout, that's he really had to think hard for that one.
Yeah. Hey, you got to give some love to Common Core Matthews here, though. Like, Got to give a little love to that.
Any other ones you guys could pick of, or the winner from those, or something?
I think Fired Housen and Taro Sugimoto are my two favorites.
Yeah, I don't know. I think I can't think of any other ones. I think you hit the highlights there.
Yeah. I think I gotta give it to the Bahama Amamas, but
yeah, that's a good one.
There's a lot of worthy contenders.
Wasn't I 1 year Jeff Carter LAPD?
I think you were, actually, yes.
Christian, your perception of your own names is so off. Christian is like two girls, one silly girl. Ah!
The Varlamov dive kick dojo.
Yeah, that's right.
What are these? Like, honestly, if you gave me like a blind roster of team names, I would just go for the dumbest one each year, and I guarantee you I hit Christian's. Like,
No, Common Core Matthews is not the dumbest one this year. Let's be fair.
You've improved. I will say you've improved. Common Core Matthews is solid. And then even Matthews Moon Pounds was not bad. So, worst team name, Pineapple Express.
Get the hell out Pineapple of here.
I don't understand it. There's no hockey relation, no pun, nothing.
Pineapple Express is a movie, and he's – Kevin is very adamant that pineapples belong on pizza. I think that's as far as it goes. And they don't.
It's also a strain of weed he needs to lay it off of if he keeps coming up with names like that.
No, but it's no relevance to hockey at all.
Which is fine. No, I know. Neither is Toot It and Boot It, but I appreciate that. Yeah,
but his is, he liked, okay, you're right.
Joaquin Malfers. I think Jack could get back to his roots.
Jack's names are hysterical. What was the other one? Did he have another Waka Flocka one or something?
He did. I think.
Oh, yeah. Tootin' and Bootin'. Isn't that a song by Waka Flocka?
And then Joaquin Malfers is his actual name, right?
Yeah.
He might have had another Waka Flocka.
I thought he did too.
Related name.
Oh no, it's not a. Or is it YG?
Okay. All right. So thanks for sending those in.
Some high quality names.
So thanks for sending in the questions, Jack. We've got another question here coming in from Kyle B. So he asked a question in the group me about, is John Tortorella gone after this year? And Isaac answered that one. So thanks, Isaac, taking our questions away from us. But he also had a question that I thought was kind of interesting. Who is the Sean McVay of the NHL? So, young guy, forward thinking, the like eternally the next big thing type of. That's at least how I'm kind of approaching this question.
I mean, could Colleton be a guy?
I hate him.
I don't think so.
I don't think he's like forward thinking at all.
Well, and that's the thing. I didn't know if he was forward thinking. I just knew that the Blackhawks were overperforming. And is he a young guy or no?
He is really young. Yeah. He might be 33 or something. Let me see how old he is.
Yeah. I think
the forward thinking is the biggest aspect of this question. I need to look up the teams to really get to. I think the answer Kruger is decidedly not the answer for the Sabres, but.
Okay, so who is the Ralph Kruger? And is that Zach Taylor? Is Zach Taylor Ralph Kruger?
No, I think it's Mike McCarthy.
Okay.
I think it's Mike McCarthy in the NFL.
Yeah, Ralph if you Kruger. Asked this question a few years ago, maybe it'd be John Cooper when John Cooper was entering the league, because he was kind of a young guy, good with the young players in Syracuse. I actually kind of want to go a different direction and not say coach, but maybe a guy like Kyle Dubas could be the Sean McVay, the like young analytics forward general manager, could be a good comparable.
What do you think of like Bryn Mawr, Ron Bryn Mawr?
Yeah, I was looking at that too.
I didn't know. He looks older than that to me. I didn't realize he's only been a coach for a couple of years now, 3 years.
Yeah. Well, he was playing in. Like 15 years ago.
No, I know he's a player. I'm just saying, like, now I thought he was
old as dirt,
you know, coaching for more than, you know, 3 years.
I don't actually think his age necessarily needs to factor in. I think the forward thinking aspect is that, I mean, obviously everyone knows McVay for being young, but I think the forward thinking aspect is what makes him successful, and it's still relatively new in all sports. So I do think that's a good pick.
Well, that's kind of what I meant. I mean, he seems to, Carolina seems to buy into the system.
And developing,
not buying into, like, you know, momentum. And
They are the analytical darlings every single year, it seems.
Yeah.
For real, though. I mean, like, they seem to put together a roster of, like, not very, like, flashy superstar players and somehow are relevant each year, and I think they're getting better and better. Like, to build a team around Aho, I was not an Aho fan at all. Like, I thought he was really overrated. And Teravainen in Chicago, I thought, like, had flashes where he looked good, but I wasn't, like, a stud. And now they're just putting together all these, like, middle of the pack players, and, you know, now have a really solid team. Like,
I think Cooper is still a perfectly fine answer for this too, though. I mean, it obviously just has a talent, but the sustained success, I mean, look at McVay teams. They always are either good or overperforming based off what their roster is. And there's a sustained success aspect to it. And I think Cooper is still a good answer for this. I just think Brendan Moore might be a better answer, just given, you know, it's not as easy to do it with Carolina as it is with Tampa.
Yeah. Okay. So, consensus, Rod the Bod. Is the Sean McVay?
Hey, will we consider Trotz almost the Bill Belichick? Obviously, doesn't have all the Stanley Cups, but as far as kind of like there's a kind of old school sort of approach to it, like
I think that's a good comparison. Yeah.
No,
I mean, you look at just the style that the Islanders play. It doesn't seem like, I wouldn't quite say it's a relic, because they still do like a lot of the things that, you know, high performing teams do, but as far as like, you know, keeping the pace down and stuff like that, it just seems to me like almost like a defense first sort of mindset. And that's what Belichick teams are.
Yeah. And you can't get Islanders fans to shut up about the Islander way, you know?
God. Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, Belichick is like, he's the best coach ever, right?
Well, I mean, yeah. I mean, I'm obviously not counting the accolades. I'm just counting, I'm considering the style, you know?
Yeah, I guess.
Is there a Bill Belichick of the league? I don't think. I just think in hockey it's a little bit harder to.
I mean, I think Hornville's the best coach.
Yeah.
Right now in the NHL by accolades and history and consistency.
Yeah, three cups. I mean, yeah.
The last 10 years, he's been coaching Stanley Cup contending teams.
Yeah.
Almost every year, regardless of where he's at and what talent. And like this year, he's continuing to do it in Florida. Well, that was such a good hire. Like, for them to get Quenneville when you have Huberto, Barkov, and, like, Bobrovsky coming in, I mean, what a good situation.
Yeah. Like, but speaking of which, that was actually kind of my question. I went, well, what's up with Bobrovsky? I thought that was a good – I mean, it's obviously you take risks when you sign goalies to that big a contract, but he was so good in Columbus, and I just feel like he's been nothing close to that in Florida. And he's losing start for Dreger.
Not anymore. He's retaken it. He's playing a lot better recently.
Has he?
He's their clear starter now again.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, if you look at, like, the past month at, like, his stats versus Dreger's, it's – Dreger's like sub 900 and Bobrovsky's at like 920, 930. He's been really good recently, actually.
I think it's just the natural variation you get every year.
It is.
Like, every goalie is going to have ups and downs. And I think you kind of, the way that it works, people ride the hot hand of whoever's doing well. I don't know if that makes sense, if they should do it or not.
Yeah.
Or, like, you know, in every city, like, or every team, you go through those swings where, like, a goalie that is a backup and, like, had no business playing is all of a sudden getting strength of starts, and then we'll have one shitty game, and then the reins will just switch.
Yeah. That's why you don't pay a goalie $10 million a year. I mean,
even
if he's playing well, it's just not worth it, I don't think.
I agree. I feel like that's a really misunderstood position. Like, they're so replaceable, I think.
Yeah.
Because as bad as that is, maybe there's a few that are, like, a little bit better. I think Carey Price in his prime was, like, probably better than most other goalies by, like, a real margin.
Yeah.
But most other years, it's, like, if you just have a goalie that's not consistently shitty,
Yep.
Then you're fine. And like, you just need to build the rest of the team around that, and you'll win games.
And there's going to be an interesting question when Vasilevsky's contract comes up, because he has been kind of an anomaly. But it is goaltending, and the Lightning are so good that they could, you would think they could put just about anyone back there, except for maybe McElhinney and Wynn, but.
Yeah. We'll see how forward thinking they are when it comes time to sign him to an extension.
Yep.
So I know we have to get to Kevin. So you want to rapid fire these last handful of questions?
Yeah.
All right. We had one more from Kevin, Talknutt playoff predictions. So let's each just say, do you think the playoffs, the standings stay as they are, or who do you think gets in, who drops out, and then who's your favorite to win it so far?
I think Foligno's favorite, Nutt-Head, I think could fight for that 6 seed. That fight for the 6 seed is going to be really close with Isaac, Foligno's favorite, and number one Nutt-Head. So that's going to be really close.
And me.
Yeah.
My players are getting hurt. I'm going to be
I didn't even realize that, the injuries. Because I had more faith in your roster than those other three, but I didn't realize you were dealing with injuries.
Yeah. I've been, getting pretty unlucky the last couple of weeks.
You still have
a bunch of postponements and shit this week. So, I don't know. I think I really could not.
That's great. You still have McGavin. So, that's, the thing that I think will – you know, barring injury to him, you're going to be in a
position. I think I'll make it, but there's a realistic chance I don't if I get unlucky the last couple of weeks with starting and stuff.
Yeah, I think of those four teams, Mike, Isaac, Jack, and Kyle, it's going to be those four teams fighting for two spots. I think Mike and Kyle make those last two.
Okay, can we talk about how many points against I have?
No.
And how statistically improbable it is.
That was
I'm serious, though. I hate this.
You should have written into the mailbag and said, why do I always have so many points against?
Can you look at it, though? Can we talk about it for a hot second here?
Yeah, well, you're getting killed.
So
yeah, you have the
I have, yes. Okay, so it's one thing for a team to, put up a shit ton of points consistently over a season. That makes sense because you picked well. But, I have – where are the points against? How do you even look at it?
It's not on the computer.
You're up 11-36.
Oh, you have to do it on the phone?
Yeah. So you've got 100 more points against over second place, which is Jack. So in 9 weeks. So you're getting an average of 10 more points against a week above the second.
The next highest.
Yeah.
Which is absolutely insane. And the thing is so you look at the points for – Brian's got the best team in points for with 1174 – and I have 11-36 against.
So it's the best team to play you every single week.
That's what I'm saying. It's absolutely insane. It doesn't make any sense to me how that happens.
Yeah, that's really bad luck.
But anyway, it happens every week.
As far as who's winning it, I mean, I really do think Steve-O and Brian are the best in the driver's seat there. I mean, look at those two rosters. Those are just really complete teams. And in order to beat, I think, either of those two teams, you're just going to have to either hope for injuries or just down weeks. Like this week, I was saying before we start rolling, I'm getting lucky against Steve-O. He doesn't have any major injuries. It's just, his players, his studs are just not putting up a lot of points. So I think you're just going to, in the playoffs against those two teams, just going to have to hope that you get them in an off week. Or a week where they don't have as many starts or one of those.
What's going to suck is when games get postponed in the fantasy playoffs, and it's just going to be – I think this year more than any other, if you make the playoffs, you have a decent chance to win.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, that's why you got to go for favorites. You have to go with somebody who's getting a bye week for sure, and that's going to be Christian or Brian and Steve-O. And I think Brian's team's ahead above Steve-O's personally. And I want to put the Grigory on him because I don't want him to ever win a nut. Favorite.
Just let me know. Just let me get the nut.
Yeah.
But his team this year, I think, is
the most. This is one of the best teams I've ever had. I'll just admit it.
And to be able to get extra pieces too with Pasternak so late is kind of a steal. And all of his gambles worked out well, I think, this year, which is nice. And
all of us should have taken that Pasternak gamble, and just none of us did.
I mean, it's a hard call, though. Especially because it's a big risk to take when you don't even know if you're going to make the playoffs. And then he came back at the earliest part of the timetable possible.
It worked out.
And then he came out and proved, and it's as good as he's ever been. So that all worked out. And like, I think Pavelski's overperforming. All of his other players that are like stud forwards are coming to play. And like to get Quinn Hughes for free is absolutely insane to me.
Yeah, it must be $32 actually. So,
But to pick up the defenseman with the most hockey points in a season off the waiver wire is
not bad.
So I think everything is sort of pointing to his team being. Yeah, there's no cracks. I mean, Mackenzie Blackwood is his crack.
Yeah.
You know, and.
Before you keep saying nice things about me, I have to cut you out because of said Grigri. we got four questions from Megan that I think we can just rapid fire through. Okay. So, who would be the better fantasy hockey asset or the better hockey player, Ella or Maddie?
Okay.
And a quick scouting report on each.
I think, well, Ella's just is a little young right now. Maddie's a little bit more experienced, has grown into her body a little bit more. And I think she has a little bit of length too for now. So I'm going to have to give the edge to Maddie for now. But knowing that Ella could get a little bit bigger and could kind of Ovechkin her way through defenders. Yeah. Oh my God, she's getting big.
She's a big beast. Talk about durable. She's got the Ovechkin body.
Yeah.
Oh my
God. She's going to be
I
gotta go Maddie for sure. I mean, look at this beast.
Especially in our league, she plays physical. So yeah. In a league that counts hits, I mean, you're just getting so much added value. She's a bit of a tank. She brings that energy every day.
I'm so Buddhist right now.
Yeah, my face knows all about her hits. Okay.
The one thing where I think Ella could develop, it's tough to take the puck from her. She was running around with a coaster today. She's tough to get the puck off her stick. So signs of young Crosby maybe, but we've got our own Crosby Ovechkin era starting up a little bit.
Oh, Mike, how much does that hurt you that Maddie's the Ovechkin of that?
I no comment.
Okay, Maddie can be the Tom Wilson then.
Oh, God.
Watch it. Keep eyes in the back of your head. All right, another quick question from Megan. What's coming first, Brian's bald head or Christian's receding hairline?
Wow. Brian's bald head. I mean, look at this lush.
What lush? Lean forward. It's too far back there, Christian.
I'll follow you.
The webcam might be a little fuzzy. I don't quite see it.
Oh my God! Look how it comes out like that. Oh my God! That's just so beautiful.
Maddie is barking right now. By the way, she did not like our analysis of the last question.
She's like, I want to be Tom Wilson.
All right, here's another one. Who will get married first between Christian and Mike?
No one.
Oh, that's a good question. It might be a tie. It might be no one.
I think me. I think just out of interest. Last time I talked to Christian, I think Christian was just at a different place.
I don't have still any interest right now. Yeah.
I mean, I'm hoping.
I still like this
bachelor life.
Mike's also got the.
I do think it's Mike.
Yeah, he's got the chick magnet, Maddie Rooney. I mean, that's a tool in the arsenal.
Tom Wilson.
All right, and then last one, Megan asks, who are you rooting for in the NCAA tournament? It's March Madness.
Good questions, Megan. Those are really good. Creighton, baby.
Creighton, baby. Why? Why Creighton? I know why, but explain it a little.
I picked. So I'm in a pool, big pool with Brian through his work. At like 2,500 entries or something. First place gets 40% of the like $5 buy-in. First place gets 40%. So I was the only person that picked Creighton. So if they win, I win like $2,000 on a $5 entry. So
well, that's a good explanation. For me, Gonzaga, because I just think they need to finally be rewarded for being the best team in the country. And I do like seeing teams get rewarded for that. And it's been a while, you know, and they have some fun players like, you know, Suggs and Timmy and Kisper are all pretty fun to watch. And they're all probably going to be first rounders in the NBA. So I do think, I mean, it's one of those, just that's a boring answer, but I do like to see great things be rewarded. Like, I like seeing Lightning win it last year, you know? Like,
you want to see them win at least one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What about you?
Same reason as Mike. I've got a good chance at winning $2,000 if Arkansas can win the national championship.
Ah.
And they're also kind of my Merkle Cup team as well. So,
Arkansas is really fun. We have a lot of Arkansas people here, and so I've been bullied into watching a lot of Arkansas games. They're pretty fun. They're pretty goddamn fun.
To give Moses Moody the ball, that game last night took about 10 years off my life. So,
were they down? I wasn't able to watch.
They're down 12. With like
10?
Yeah. In the last 6 of their last 7 wins, they've overcome deficits of 10 points or more in the second
half. Right where I want them.
Yeah. So,
right where they want them.
Battle tested. But not good for my
heart.
Baylor next, right?
Yeah. Baylor next, yeah. So,
although Baylor looked beatable in Villanova, I mean, that was a close game for the majority of it.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, all right. I just texted Kevin. He's gonna hop on.
And then what do you think of Rambler? Actually, not. We got a bunch of Ohio while we're waiting. Go Buckeyes, right, PJ?
Salt in the wound. Salt in the wound. Wayne Washington, wide open for 3. Bricks.
He was like wide open. He was like almost like offensively open. It's like.
Yeah.
The Big Ten really.
If they would have played Anil Roberts, they would have won probably.
What's it?
If they would have played Anil Roberts, they probably would have won.
Who?
Anil Roberts.
Oh, Anil Roberts. Oh, God. Or at least got in the backboard cover, you know.
What? Or at least got put some braces on. What?
Or at least gotten like a backdoor cover if they're
should have sent him to the orthodontist before that game.
Oh God.
You guys got your questions queued up for Kevin, or we're putting him in the hot seat.
Yeah, I mean, I'll even defend Kevin because I sort of defended Kevin too. I mean, obviously, when you have a guy like Blake Wheeler, you should see if you could trade him before you could, you know, drop him. But I think it's the same thing with Isaac, where it's like I actually like the mindset of like not getting too caught up in a guy's draft position, you know. And also, Blake Wheeler hasn't been elite this year. He's been kind of average, kind of.
And I've been on the record as saying I actually don't really even mind the Petrangelo drop. Like, I think he probably should be on a team, but I don't think that's a terrible one.
Yeah, no, we'll give Kevin plenty of time to defend each of these moves, but yeah.
He's having a little technical difficulties. Gotta send
him. How are you going
to – Leslie, I looked at the symptoms and you have internet connectivity problems.
Christian, do our ad read for this episode.
what are some of the things that we could do? Oh, I guess we could do for hims to as part of Megan's question with the hair loss stuff.
Oh, here he is. He's blending us now. All right, Kevin, can you hear us?
Yeah, can you guys hear me?
Yeah, where's your camera? There we go.
Yeah. All right. Welcome to the podcast.
Hello, gentlemen. I'm excited to be here. Sorry about the technical difficulties. Rooney, thank you for it.
How's it going, man?
I appreciate it, buddy. Appreciate it. Are we live right now?
We're live.
Yeah, we are. First time, long time.
Pressure's on.
I know. I'm nervous. I've never been on one of these before. Probably because I won't shut the hell up, so no one's ever invited me.
Just imagine everybody else in their underwear, or just have Christian stand up, because I'm sure he actually is in his underwear. So, oh yeah, okay.
Please don't sit down. Please don't sit down. Keep standing.
I'll whip it out.
Whip it out for me, big boy. Excited to be on. First of all, I just want to say, super happy to be part of the league. Having the first 2 years were a little rough, but this year it's actually coming together, and it's a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Opposed to other fantasy leagues I've been involved in, and you guys are all really into it. Everybody that listens to Talknutt, everyone's into this, and it's a lot of fun. So let's get right into some hockey questions. And I think this one is a little bit more of a simple of the two of them. It's kind of directed towards Rooney, but all three of you guys.
This is a Blackhawks question?
Yeah, the Blackhawks.
We answered it.
Oh, did? Okay. Yeah. Okay. So don't go back.
What's your thoughts? We'll also add, like, we appreciate how active you are in the league. Because, like, the worst thing you can have is someone who isn't active in the league and making moves. It makes it more fun.
I thought you were going to go, we appreciate how active you are in the league and dropping your fourth overall.
We'll give you plenty of space to talk us through your mindset for that. So I was going to wait on that one a little bit.
There's actually like a shrine to Blake Wheeler in my bedroom on my side, not Natalie's. And every morning I'm like, fuck you, Kevin. You're such an idiot. Are you swearing to Talknutt? I'm not sure if we're allowed to do that.
Oh, we've sworn.
We're gonna have to put an explicit tag next to this one.
For those with small children, Kevin Finland's coming on. So
yeah. Well, Mike also called Oral Roberts anal Roberts. So
well, no,
it was for like the oral.
Well, that's because they've got that. Oh, is that they can't have sex?
But that was what I was going for. I couldn't think of another.
They don't have sex on that campus. Like, so you know they do weird stuff like backdoor stuff because, like, oh, well, I haven't lost. I haven't lost my virginity. Sorry, Brian's mother-in-law, who's probably in the room. So yeah, the Blackhawks to me, I think it is just who they are. Like hot, cold. They're in a rebuild. Now, hopefully you didn't talk about this because I really wanted to get the panel's thoughts, and partially selfishly because I'm 90% sure I'm going to make the playoffs, is what are your guys' thoughts heading into the playoffs?
Or who's going to win?
Yeah, just like overall of the teams that are there. I mean, like, I know Stephen Chow has really had a really good year, but I think he's been pretty healthy, right? He hasn't gotten bit by the COVID bug. Brian's obviously scored up a lot of points, but you and Christian are right there. And then we got some stragglers, some people that are like – could still make it. I mean, it's still fairly competitive in my thoughts. So yeah. I'm just curious what your guys' thoughts are.
I mean, COVID is obviously, I think, going to be everyone's biggest fear is that they have, like, their first round pick lose two games in a week.
Oh, like this week for me with McDavid?
Yeah. I've had weeks like that with my Lightning players with Vasilevsky and Hedman. And it's like, if those are your first two picks, you're like, well, shit. Like, those are already a risk to take those two at that high. So – yeah, look, I think that's going to be the biggest thing everyone's worried about. Injuries, you can't really do much about injuries. Everyone, yeah. It's hockey. It's not flag football. Like, you're going to deal with injuries. Losing games from COVID is going to be the biggest worry.
Yeah, I mean, I'm in that boat right now with this week. I actually had a decent week, but I lost Price, Toffoli, Nurse for like three or four. I mean, I lost like my three top scorers, maybe not Price, but two top scorers to COVID. So yeah, I agree there. We have any predictions, any bold predictions out there? Who's going to win it all?
I don't think we talked about this a little bit.
I think we're all kind of in on the Brian boat this year.
The Brian boat. I agree. I definitely agree. Really. Yeah,
I'm only saying that to make sure that he doesn't win.
Yeah, I'm not going to stand for this level of greed that's putting on me right now.
And I'm just adding on another layer. I think he is – I mean, seriously, I do think his team's the best, but he's Brian, so he'll find a way to lose in the playoffs.
Yep.
It's not a joke.
I honestly think, like, all four of us here have a real chance, like, at winning. You know, I think it takes – a good week from any of us. And I think all of us have shown that we're capable of having like top point weeks, you know?
Especially, so. I mean, every year, any team that's in the playoffs can win in fantasy because there's just so much parity. I mean, the difference in a week is like not significant and there's so much variation week to week. So like, if you make it, you got a chance. I do think that the bye week is just such a huge advantage. So Steve-O and Brian have like for sure the upper hand. But that said, I feel like most years it turns out we're the one and two don't win it anyway. I think the dark horse pick for me is Christian's team. I think they're coming together well and like
it's getting hot at the right time for sure.
I played myself.
I'm worried though because Barkov has like been out and Malkin's week to week as soon as he was heating up, so I'm a little worried about that.
Yeah. That would be that's kind of where my thoughts are. I don't know.
So questions for Kevin, though. You've asked us a couple of questions. I know you wanted to do battle with Mike Rooney here. I don't think we can ignore the elephant in the room. We've talked about Blake Wheeler enough.
I do think Blake Wheeler, in all seriousness, that was definitely a frustration move. I was so angsty in the beginning of the season to want to have a good year because I've sucked the last 2 years. But really, this is completely different than fantasy football. You really have to learn and draft. And I do have a question that I'll probably come up here about that with some of like the guys who aren't doing well this year. But I think also it's like when they draft, they like, I think just think there's so much variance between when you draft. You could draft players and be like, hey, I have a stud team, and then just none of them perform, right? Like that can really happen in fantasy hockey, right?
Yeah,
for sure. Yeah.
Okay. I mean, I guess that's kind
of. I think with someone with the name recognition of Blake Wheeler, though, I'm curious, did you like try offering him up in trades? Because
no, that was a total. You got so lucky on that. I was trying to like basically shuffle my line, and I think I may have had like two players out for COVID that didn't want to drop. So I just like, oh, I'll just drop him. Like not even really thinking about what I was doing. Like we could totally say it was like a rookie mistake right there, which probably is the best that I did it. Cause I'm in the league for 10 years. I'll never do it again. So
yeah.
Christian, you got to win this year with that right there.
I know. Well, I think the biggest thing too, and I've defended moves like that. Cause I know Isaac has made moves where he's dropped players that scratch your head, and I've defended and that, like, I actually do appreciate the mindset of not getting too locked in on a player's draft, you know, space.
Yeah, I agree.
But that early in the season, you know, it's something where you probably should try to offer him up in trades and see what you can get, what value you can get. But like, look, like I have Blake Wheeler, and this week has actually been good, but I do think he's been kind of an average fantasy hockey player this year. Yeah. That kind of he's had a lot of minuses, and I think he's under a point per game too. So, but it's just, you know, it's the upside that you're hoping you get out of him. But yeah, I mean, I actually do appreciate that mindset of like, because I think there are players that even I'm guilty of that I hold on to for too long because I drafted them high enough and it's like I don't want to lose them and, you know, get someone who's undrafted. But that's just a mindset you got to get rid of.
Like, really quickly. And that's kind of where we're going to segue over to the Petrangelo one, Rooney, is that like I think I did two key drops this year. I was the Wheeler and the Petrangelo, and I regret one of them, but the Petrangelo one I don't really regret. Now, partially, and I think you guys will agree with this, it's really easy to not regret dropping a decent defenseman when you have the top two scoring defenseman in the league this year, which is luck, right? Like, there's no way to know going in you're going to have that. Because I think we all thought Cole Makar was going to be that guy, and he's been, you know, on and off injury. But Petrangelo, I looked at it, and I was Billy Beaning this. I was just looking at the numbers, and I was like, I feel like if, with those two better defensemen, Petri and – right, I say Petri and Nurse – I thought I could probably just stream defenseman. I'm just looking for solid minutes. And that's like, well, I've got Gudas in there right now. Like, I know he's not going to like steal a week for me, right? But if I could just get some positive minutes. And I've noticed I followed Petrangelo. He's been injured, right, Rooney?
I mean, he got injured after you dropped him, but he plays 26 minutes a game or something in Vegas. And like, I don't know. Here's my thoughts. First of all, Gudas is like actually a good playable fourth defenseman because he gets like 10 hits a game. So he's actually like totally like that pickup.
Yeah, and he gets literally getting
like go through his last. He had 11 hits 3 games ago, and like, you know, that's 2 fantasy points just in hits.
That's an assist.
So that's not a bad pickup. I totally like that.
That's how I would play if I played hockey with my large body.
Petrangelo is like, okay, so he's. He's good. First of all, he's a good hockey player. He's playing on the second unit in Vegas and getting like 26 minutes a game. So he's getting more minutes than Shea Theodore. I think the best team in the league right now. And like, I think Petri is like good, obviously really good. I think he's overperforming.
Oh God. Yeah. 100%.
And then like Darnell Nurse,
also
happens to, but yeah, so he's playing on Edmonton and like is really good, but he's clearly not as good as he's doing right now. I think if I were to pick like from right this second, I think that Petrangelo is comparable, if not the best three of those, definitely in terms of hockey player, but fantasy, I think they're all kind of similar. It's like, I think it's similar to the Blake Wheeler in a sense that like he was playing bad when you dropped him, but I think his trajectory is probably better. Like this is where I'm coming from. And part of it was I had, there's only so many weeks left in the season. So when someone drops someone that I really want, you can only spend your money before, you know, if you just hold on your money and don't spend it, it's not doing any good. So like, I figured that the number of like,
superstar commissioner pays us out that cash value. That's what I was told.
Okay. Well, I agree.
You were told
the commissioner pays us out that money if we don't use that. Everybody was going to talk, not just hit Brian up for your money.
Yeah, you're gonna be paid. You're gonna be paid five times more than what the buy-in.
I was gonna say the buy-in is increasing to $500 next year.
That said, I regret it. If I would have known that Quinn Hughes was getting dropped, I would have not done what I did, and I would have spent $33 on Quinn Hughes over Pietrangelo any day. Yep. I thought there were going to be limited numbers of like superstar players.
Right. I talked about that a little bit. I think that's probably with the defensive in the defense area, it's still keeping that going. I think if I regret more, it was not paying more because I had the money to outbid Brian. I think this is part of my novice, like I don't know as much about hockey as you guys. I'm having a good year, partially from good drafting, and then partially also some luck, like Nurse and Petri, or like carried my team early on. Yeah, Toffoli. Like I was a luck. Like I think those guys are vastly outperforming, which you do need in a good season. Like you need guys to outperform, especially when you draft 10th. But I do wish the Quinn Hughes thing I'd have picked up more, or like I would have paid more money to go after picking him up. I didn't do that because of something Brian had said in the past, was like cannibalizing, like having two defensemen on the same team. And I have
Myers.
Myers, thank you. Yeah, Tyler Myers. And I definitely don't think they're comparable. Quinn Hughes is definitely superior. I should have gone for Hughes and drop Myers, right? Would you guys agree with that?
I mean, so Tyler Myers to me is like fantasy irrelevant almost. Like he's not that good. He's like kind of on the – like I think I'd rather have Radko Gudas than Tyler Myers. But like Quinn Hughes, the problem with Quinn Hughes is he literally at the time when he got dropped, he had the most points of any defenseman and most hockey points, hockey, like most assists and goals. And he's like on the first power play unit and like, I don't know, was a rookie of the year. Like he's just a really good guy, like really good player. And I just had $7 because I spent so long on Pietrangelo, who's now on IR. So I was like, I had no money to
hold on.
Brian got us got an absolute steal.
Yeah, I agree. Can I ask? There's more for Christian, Brian. All three of you. The Miro Hens, I can't say his last name. I didn't drop him because of some of these aggressive moves I've made earlier in the season, and it's like kind of paying off. Well, I mean, do you guys think that I was wrong for I would be wrong for dropping him, even though
You'd be wrong for dropping him because he's really good. Dallas has a lot of games like on hand. Like they're gonna, because they've had a lot of games postponed. Yeah. So I mean, just for sheer games numbers alone, you shouldn't. But he's also like maybe their best player. Is the other first power player is Klingberg?
He's not. It's Klingberg. That's the only downside to Heskanen. But like
yeah.
But Heskanen is still good. Really good.
It almost doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Going into the season, I thought he was your best defenseman. So. I thought Pietrangelo was your best defenseman, and then I thought
I thought it was him or Pietrangelo, and then to be honest, to be completely honest, because I refrained from dropping him, and I think it's that, and I also again over aggressive because I sucked the last 2 years. I was really hell bent on moving Jake Guenthel, who I drafted second. And I'm kind of happy Brian, like, without talking me out of it, talked me out of it because he definitely came on later in the season once the Penguins got their heads out of their ass. Because he's definitely starting to play like the second round draft pick that he is. That being said, this would be my time for disclaimer that if anybody wants to make an offer for Evander Kane, I could use some help around goalie or center. There we go. Using this platform for good for myself.
Self advertisement. Wow. Okay, that's actually that brings up a good point. I don't know when the trade deadline is, but
Evander Kane's really good, actually.
Oh, Evander Kane's like super dope. But the problem is I have so many good wingers. I mean, it helped me out right now, but.
Yeah, his floor is always pretty nice because of shot hits, like, penalty minutes.
Oh, he's actually having a good year, too.
He's like a Quinn Hughes of the offense, in my opinion.
He shoots a ton. And hits. I mean, actually, I'll try to trade you for.
I'm gonna get a bunch of really bad offers now, like just from a bunch of people. Like, oh, okay.
Wait, right. you want a center?
Depends on what center you're gonna offer me.
I mean, I could take
Connor McDavid off your hands. Yes.
Brian O'Reilly.
So, just real quick, I actually just changed the trade deadline because it happened or it was set for after the season was over. So trade deadline is now April 8th. I didn't want to say April 1st just to give people a couple more times, but April 8th, last date to trade.
Yeah, no trade deadline.
It's still even too late, in my opinion. But
dude, how wild would it be? It would be the Wild West of the trade deadline. If there was no trade deadline, you could trade during the playoffs.
That'd be a little suspect.
Like Brian makes it, and like Mike offers, like, who's playing against in the finals. Okay, I'll give you Connor McDavid for, you know, a back
the,
box.
Well, it would go the other way. It would be, I'd be trading against Brian's opponents every week.
No, that's what I'm saying. No,
because he paid that money out, you know.
Just really don't want Brian. You go, both you gentlemen, Christian and Rooney, you guys have won the league, right?
Yeah,
Brian just coming in.
We're the only like back-to-back winners ever, so no big deal.
Mike, do you have two or three?
Yikes!
It's irrelevant.
Hey, I've come in second four times.
Brian is always a bridesmaid and never a bride. Is that what I'm hearing?
Yeah. He literally has gotten second four times. It's hysterical.
wait, who? Like, I have twice, right? I've won it twice.
You've won it three times. I've won it three times.
The co-hosts on this podcast have combined for five Talknutts.
and four second places.
And a lot of second places, yeah. So you could trust us. That's why the Nutt-Heads keep coming back. We get
it. I think I gotta trust. I can't believe I'm gonna say these words coming out. I think I gotta trust Christian and Rooney, Brian. I'm sorry.
No, Brian puts together a good team every year, and has
just not good enough.
I put together the second best team every year. Come on, guys.
Yeah. Last year
I had the mathematically best team like ever in the history of the league.
And you can trust Mike because he's reading a book called How Not to Be Wrong: The Mathematical Way of Thinking. So, mathematically, it is
wrong. That's not the real title, so you dumbass.
Well, I haven't read the book. That's why I was wrong about the title.
Brian, I just want to say you're staying true to your Bengals roots. We're going to make the playoffs every year. We're never going to win a game, but we're going to make the playoffs every year.
That sounds like something PJ would say as a Browns fan. So I don't like you lumping me in with that.
But, he's like, we're not going to make the playoffs ever because we suck.
Hey, we'll make the playoffs, but then lose in the first round. It's fine. My fantasy hockey franchise is the Bengals of the Ron Talknutt.
That's not true. The Bengals are like, you're more relevant than the Bengals
right now.
Yeah, no, it's not true because the Bengals are always scarier.
What?
The Bengals are always scarier.
All right, well, thanks for listening. That was a good discussion that we had.
We like pondered that for a while too before.
Wait, ran it back.
You can see the hamster running in the wheel.
I know. I could be ready. Fuck off.
So Brian, you said, did you have any other questions for me or?
No, I didn't prepare at all. I was just hoping other people would ask you questions. Anything else you want to talk about before we get to our game show, which you're more than welcome to stay for if you would like.
Sure. I mean, do you guys have any free tips for me to make me a winner and not lie? Because I'd love to win before Brian.
I would say one thing, I don't know if you do this, I haven't really been paying attention, but one thing that I've seen that helps me from when I first started, like a couple, 10 years ago or whatever, is like really in the playoffs, pay attention to the number of games like that they're playing each week. I think you're doing that. It seems like you get a lot of games each week. But that's like such a big advantage, is like rotating out players that probably are better but have fewer games to players that are a little bit worse but can play two more games or whatever in a week.
Okay. What I was doing this week. I'm going to lose to who's Flinga? Flinga? I can't say his last name.
Flinga.
Yeah. Who is that?
Kyle. Yeah. He's the new guy.
He's 4-5. He's right there. I was hoping to beat him this week, but I lost like 12 games or something like that to COVID. So,
yeah.
He's still not doing bad, but he's going to win this week. But I definitely been doing that. And just,
I want to do
the waiver wire for when someone drops Blake Wheeler.
Yeah, keep it that maybe that for one thing is for like to avoid those is look at where people finished last year before dropping them, and like Gensel too. Typically, I think it's like so tempting, especially at the beginning when somebody gets off to like a shitty start, to just be like, I don't want a piece of this anymore. But like looking at where they finished last year and like what they do over their career is helpful to kind of figure out where you might think they'll finish this year. Obviously, people have like good years and bad years, but.
All three of you guys have been doing this for like 8+ years, right?
Yeah. Okay. I think we all started in 2010.
Are you doing three originals from like the starting of it, or was Peach part of it?
So it started as in high school, our senior year. So it was just the Ohio crew. So like PJ is an OG, Jack is an OG, Isaac, and me. I think that's it. I think we only have four people from the old guard here.
Wow. Okay.
But then like Christian and Mike have been every year except one. So it's like.
Okay.
And Dave.
And Dave.
When is Steven Chow getting? Because he's.
Oh, and Steve-O, yeah.
Was he year one?
He was. He might have been two. I don't know. But he's been there since.
Around there.
Yeah. But he's
like John back.
Steve-O, I think, is like low key the best fantasy hockey manager. Like, of all of us.
He's really good.
He's really good. He makes such unbelievable, like, good moves every year and somehow has, like, a really badass team by the end of the year. And I just don't even realize it until he's, like, in the playoffs winning.
Yeah.
It's like
the silent assassin.
He really is.
He's good at drafting. He doesn't make panic trades. He doesn't make panic drops. He's on top of it.
Yeah.
Who is this?
Steve-O.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Gotcha. I was going to say Megan.
She's just like Megan drafts good because she – well, actually, she, like, doesn't even – I don't think Brian even does it anymore for her. Megan, what? Like
– I never have.
Have you never – literally never done it?
No.
Oh, she's just really good.
Yeah, I think Megan's had just really bad luck this year. I didn't think her team was going to be this underperforming.
Yeah.
All right. You guys want to get into our game show?
Yes.
Kevin, would you like to join?
I would love to.
It requires very little hockey knowledge, kind of. This is something that I mentioned to Christian when we did our solo pod 2 weeks ago. It's a game like all the games that I stole from another podcast. Basically, the premise of the game is there's a lot of international flavor in the NHL. I'm going to give you a literal English translation of a player's last name. And you guys have to try to guess who it is. So I'll give you the country of origin and then what the literal translation into English is. And we'll give you each, say, two guesses. We'll go the order that it is on the Zoom. So we'll go Christian, Mike, Kevin for the first one. Then we'll go Mike, Kevin, Christian, and just kind of go that way. Whoever has guessed the most correct.
When you're a player off your team.
Gets to win. It's not a person on my team. It's just an NHL player.
Oh, no. I mean, I get to pick a player that you give me for nothing.
You get to zero of your cab dollars for real dollars at the end. All right. You guys ready? Make a simple game.
Actually, before we do this, I have an idea, Brian.
Okay.
Can we do this year for draft picks for next season or maybe starting next season? Can we pick it by remaining dollars? Give you draft seed?
That's interesting.
Ooh, I kind of don't mind that.
I liked it because I think that's a good idea.
We'll bring it to a vote. Right. So whoever has the most fab gets to pick their draft spot first.
Yeah.
Okay.
Instead of not to spend it for no reason at the deadline.
Okay.
Yeah. If you're really bad, you know, like if you have no chance of winning, now you have money, so at least you're in like a lottery to.
Yeah. Adds another little flavor to it.
The only thing, though, also is like, what are the tiebreaker procedures? Because you still have people who
moves made
zero and have
100 moves made. So if you're keeping your fab but still making a lot of moves,
yes, I like that.
Yes, okay, I'm good with that. Yeah.
And then, as always, the second tiebreaker is just who I like better. So.
Yeah. Actually, that's first, and then these other things are tiebreakers. Brian just picks the draft order each year.
I just pick the winner. Wow. I mean. All right, let's jump into it. And we are going to start with a Swedish player. So Christian, you're the first guesser, then Mike, then Kevin, okay? So Swedish NHL player, his last name translated into English is Blade Mountain. Blade Mountain.
Ekholm? Matthias Ekholm? Matthias Ekholm?
It is not Matthias Ekholm.
Blade Mountain. Oh my god.
After the first go through, so you'll each get two guesses, I'll give you their position for the next one. How about that?
Okay.
Unless you want it now. Can you give it now?
Christian didn't get a guess.
We'll start next time. Blade Mountain. Have you brushed up on your Swedish? Did you pass?
Vill du tala engelska? That's if you speak English.
Did you pass?
I pass.
That's some real weenie shit.
I don't even know.
Well, I don't. It's definitely. I want to say Nicholas Backstrom. I'm thinking like Black, you know, Backstrom, but I don't even know if he's Swedish.
He is
Swedish. Yeah, so like Nicholas Backstrom. Am I right?
It is not Nicholas Backstrom.
God damn it! Okay,
this is a defenseman. A defenseman.
It is what?
Blade Mountain. A defenseman. I'll give you. Okay, so here's what we're gonna do starting next round. Position for the first set of guesses. I'll give you what division they're in for the second.
I like that.
Okay.
All right, so this is a defenseman in the Central Division. Blade
Mountain. Ekholm wasn't a bad guess then.
Yeah. You're swimming in the right pool.
And this, oh, man, they
who's up for this? So Kevin is up first?
Oh, yeah, now I'm up first. Should they read all the
divisions? No, how are we doing this? Is it Christian again?
It's Christian again. We're just
defenseman in the Central.
I got a guess. No.
Swedish.
I think this is a Swedish name.
Is it Boqvist?
It is not Adam Boqvist. No.
He's Finnish. I think he's Finnish, isn't he?
He is Swedish.
He's Swedish?
Yeah.
They're next to each other, so it's basically the same thing.
God, this is a good game.
Yeah, shit, this is hard.
I mean, it's guessing, basically, unless you actually know Swedish.
Yeah, but I'm just wondering, do these things sound similar? Like, does Blade Mountain mean that there's, like, two syllables or, like, it's a longer name? Because I would think that Ekholm couldn't mean Blade Mountain. But I don't know that.
It's like a compound. I've never taken it. But, yeah, it's like a compound name. So, it's...
You know what I mean?
Yeah. All right, so, Mike, you're up.
I'm thinking.
I thought you said you had a guess. Was it Boqvist?
It was Boqvist, yeah.
Okay.
I've got a guess.
It starts with a B. I was like, oh, Blades.
Blade.
God, this is not easy.
Clearly.
Can I give my spot up to Kevin if he has a guess right now?
So I do have a guess.
Sure.
Ekblad?
Who?
I can't say Ekblad. The Panthers.
Ekblad, Aaron Ekblad?
He's not American. He's Canadian. He's Canadian anyway.
He's Canadian? Okay. I'm just like, okay. He's Canadian.
Ekblad is a Swedish name though.
Okay, that's what I was. See, at least I'm thinking about it the right way.
He was actually on my list, but I'm not going to do him anymore. His name means oak leaf.
Okay, so.
A Central Division.
Central Division defenseman.
Rooney's like, if I get this wrong, they're going to just wipe out my entire family. My life depends on this.
I can't think of another defenseman that is remotely Swedish sounding that's in the Central.
If you don't get it right, I'm exiling you. Or if you pass again, I'm exiling you to Blade Mountain.
I don't want everyone to just sit and wait on me while I think. Roman Josi.
It is not Roman Josi. It was John Klingberg. Klingberg. Johnny Blade Mountain.
Yeah, Berg being mountain, that makes sense.
Berg is mountain, yes.
I think Roman Josi's Swiss anyway.
He is Swiss.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, round two. Score is still even at zero. Mike, it's going to be your guess first, then Kevin, then Christian. This is a Swedish forward whose last name means corner branch. Corner branch. Swedish forward.
Can you give position? Is it a winger or is that cheating?
It's a winger.
Yes. Okay.
I'll give you the division now anyway. It's Central Division.
Central Division forward.
Central Division winger. Last name means corner branch, and he is Swedish.
This is going to be another dumb one. Is it Teravainen?
It is not Teravainen.
Is he Russian? He's Finnish,
I believe, yeah.
Oh, man. That's a good guess. No, I don't think he's I don't think he's Swedish. But I'm gonna go with Nino. I'm gonna go with the Hurricanes. Niederreiter.
Niederreiter. He is also Swiss. It is not Nino Niederreiter.
He's Swiss. This is the hard part about this. Is like all these guys not from the U.S. or Canada. I have no idea. Or even the one from the U.S. and Canada. I can't tell. I'm not good at the etymology of names. Like when I hear a name, I can't tell where it's from.
Yeah, when it's literally all Canadian things. The little English translation for the next round is Atkinson.
Son of Atkins.
Son of Atkins. Damn it.
He's a Swedish winger in the central, right?
Yep.
What is it? What's the word again? What's his translation?
Corner branch. So a branch that's just sitting over.
Arvidsson. Victor Arvidsson.
That would be son of Arvid. No, it is not Victor Arvidsson.
I was thinking Arvid Arbor, like branch tree.
That's not bad.
I forgot about the sunny
corner.
Do you want another piece of information? It's really hard, obviously.
Mike, I want you to tell him the name via text so he can guess it and be right.
Do you want the team, is that giving away too much?
I think the team
it's
giving
kind of an away. Advantage, but the thing is, well, for Christian not to get it, to be able to go first kind of puts him in.
What's a good clue that I can give?
I think you guys have a better advantage than me. I think
I could give you what his first
going name on a fantasy team right now. If all these guys, I assume, are fantasy relevant.
You pick they're all relevant-ish. Not all of them, but
he's most. Got like a fourth liner.
They're all guys you know.
They are all okay. They're all like popular guys.
You want? Yeah. I don't know what else I can give you there.
Is their team currently in a playoff spot?
Okay. Yes.
That's a good one.
Yes.
Okay. Bottom here. So a good team in the central.
Swedish corner branch.
Wait, central.
So the teams that are currently in a playoff spot are Tampa, Carolina, Florida, and Chicago.
Bunch of Swedish players though on Florida, right?
Oh, I think I know it.
I feel like if you got it, you should just be able to guess. We've all had a shot. Go, Christian.
That's the problem with this game. I just feel bad waiting and thinking.
Yeah. Christian, you go. If you got a guess, you should go.
Is it Hornquist?
It is Patrick Hornquist.
Hey. Good boy. I think once we each get a fair guess at it, like at that.
Yeah, point. Yeah. So that's I like that.
Maybe let's just say we can just shoot off names and whoever gets it first wins. And then everybody has an unlimited chances and you just keep going. And then whoever gets it.
Okay, that's fine.
And then, you know what I'm saying? Then we can not have to just wait awkwardly.
Okay.
So it means Hornquist means corner branch.
Corner branch, yes. All right.
In center stage, he's off to the side.
What's it?
It's my Swedish. I know a little Swedish. IKEA, you know? Like.
All right, this is a Czech player. A Czech player. He is a forward in the Central Division.
Jesus Christ.
And his last name means bad weather. Bad weather.
Borgstrand?
It's not Borgstrand.
Is he Danish?
He is Danish.
That's my dad.
There's too many countries.
Is it?
I want Europe and then Canada and you can put Russia in Europe too. That counts.
Is there any Mexican?
What's his last name again?
Hockey players.
Bad weather.
Czech.
Also, I'm taking a lot of these from Reddit, so unverified. I verified.
He says winger, right?
For all of our Czech listeners are just clowning on us because they're like, that's not true. That's not what that means.
Like, God, these Americans are idiots.
Central Division forward, bad weather.
I had my first guess. So I think it's Christian, then Rooney.
No, I think we just shoot them out as you go. As many as you want. And then whoever
get out my phone and just start Googling names. That Bjorkstrøm is Danish. Okay.
This is the hardest one so far, too. So, if you all agree to give up, then we can move on.
Is it Rupe?
It is not Rupe Hintz.
Is he Czech?
I think he's Finnish, actually.
Rupe Hintz. This team is in the upper half of the division. They're currently in a playoff spot. Rupe Hintz is Finnish.
Yeah, shit.
One thing the Blackhawks, I feel like they got a decent amount of Czech players, but
this guy was a pretty well-lauded prospect who's kind of starting to come into his own this year. He is a center in the Central Division, and his last name means bad weather.
Is that a playoff team?
On a playoff team.
Shit.
Oh, I forgot.
Verhigge? Oh, he's a winger, right?
Who?
Verhigge.
Yeah, not Verhigge.
He's a young guy that's coming in, doing well. Yanni Gord?
Not Yanni Gord.
Oh, that's good. That's another good guess, too.
Kirby Dach is American, right?
He's Canadian.
Canadian.
Because that's what I was thinking, buddy. I knew he was Canadian.
Dach is German for roof, actually.
Roof?
Roof, yeah.
So he's German. He's not Canadian.
Who are the Czech players in the league?
Touted prospect, Central Division, center.
Pius Suter is Swiss, right?
I don't know. I'll take your word for it.
I think he's Swiss, and I don't think it's him.
He is Swiss.
Yes. Yeah, I didn't think it, but it's clearly not him because he'd have been like, oh, you got it right.
Yeah.
It was not him.
Not bad guess, though.
Yeah, because he's center. Can you give us the team and then we'll move?
Team is Carolina.
A new center from Carolina?
Not necessarily new, but he's like a young guy who's starting to come into his own. He's starting to live up to the hype that he had as a prospect.
I mean, it's not Aho. It's not – who's their, like, second-line center right now? I don't even know.
You got to give it to us.
Perhaps the answer to this question.
Is it?
What did you say?
It's not Natchez, right?
It is Natchez. Martin Natchez. Good old bad weather.
That's a hard one.
That is a hard one.
That's a really hard one.
All right, we're going to switch divisions to the Central Division now this time. A winger. A Finnish winger whose last name translates to wave.
Finnish
winger in the Central?
Yep.
You said in the Central?
Yes, I did.
Okay.
Finnish winger, wave. Oh, God. The all Scandinavian names, they all sound the same to me, so this is all like totally. Radulov.
Nope. He's Russian.
Russian.
Yeah, I know, but it sounds like a wave.
I'm blanking.
Is it Hintz?
It is not Rupe Hintz, no.
Top or bottom?
Yeah. Bottom.
Okay.
Is Fabry on Detroit?
That it is not Robbie Fabry. He is Canadian, I think.
Yeah.
It really makes me think of an Italian name anyway, to be honest.
Robert Fabry.
Fabry.
Roberto.
Fabry.
Finnish winger in the Central Lower.
Bottom?
So it'd be Nashville, Columbus, Dallas, and Detroit, right?
Yes.
He's in bottom. I feel like Detroit's got a lot of players that are, I don't say unknowns, but because they're so bad, they just got so much youth.
This is probably the most well-known player of the bunch that we've gone through.
Well, I mean, those are all, I felt like the only one that was not well known was,
yes.
Sorry, what was it?
A winger, a Finnish winger whose last name means wave. He is currently residing at near the bottom of the Central Division.
Forsberg.
Yeah. That's something mountain.
Son of Arvidsson is son of Arvid.
He's Swedish as well.
Who like the Sagan? It's American.
I know Barkov is Finnish, but he's in the top half. And Barkov is a Russian name anyway.
Should be an easy one, Brian said.
Aho's Finnish, but Aho's in the top half.
I don't know any of these.
I didn't expect any of you to know any of these.
Some.
Rutu?
Goose Forsling? Is Gusta? Is...
All right, here's your last hint. You're making me all real disappointed right now.
Is it a jacket? Is it a jacket?
That's a yes.
That was going to be the hint.
You're making me disappointed on a personal level here.
Okay. All right. Fair. Bjorkstrand. No. What?
He's Danish. A Finnish winger.
Oh, Laine.
Oh, Laine.
There you go.
Yeah.
Patrick Laine. Patrick Wave.
I don't think of him as a jacket yet, okay?
He got traded this year.
Yes, right. Yeah.
Okay, that's fair. And he is the most well-known of the ones that we said, too.
Also, there was a Tuomo Ruutu call? Did someone say
Ruutu? Ruutu, yeah.
His last name means rectangle.
Thanks, Brian.
All right, you want to just do a couple more?
Sure. Yeah, I don't think there are any winners in this one. I think the loser.
Oh, I'm winning one.
All the nutheads are losers if they've listened this long.
Mike has two, so yeah, Mike's up right now.
This is a Czech center in the East Division, so not the Central, whose last name means tailor. So like someone who sews, like a tailor.
Oh. Czech center in the East, right? Okay.
Czech center in
Barzal.
The
Barzal.
Not Barzal.
Zibanejad.
Not Zibanejad. I appreciate the strategy though. Just rapid fire.
It's better than having just like sitting here.
For sure. I wasn't being facetious. Oh.
He's 40. Yeah, the Czech names really mess with me. He's doing better. I keep thinking of Swiss last names.
Well, there's like three Swiss NHL players, so.
Bergeron.
That's French, right?
Not Bergeron.
It's French, Katie.
Oh, Krejci.
David Krejci is correct.
Wow, that's a good one.
Nice chair.
Got it. So, Christian 2, Mike 1, Kevin 0 right now?
That's correct.
Wait, what does his name mean again?
Taylor. Like a...
Okay.
How did you guess it? If you don't even know what he said.
Just check centers.
That's a good
one. I've made a joke in our group text about if you're a Czech hockey fan or an LO's crate training.
Oh, yeah, that's true. That's true. That is, yeah.
Okay, right.
First to three. I like that. Let me find another one. Let's go back to Sweden.
Dahmerson.
Ah, damn it. I was going to guess that. I'm saving that one.
Son of a Hjalmar.
hold on. All right, a Swedish center in the Central Division. Brook Stream. So like
Brook Stream.
Brook Stream. like River.
Swedish center in the central. Okay.
Brookstream.
Arvidsson. Son of the brook.
Son of the brook.
Johansson? No, no, that's son of Johan.
Brookstream. Brookstream.
Top or bottom? Just give us all the info so that we only serve.
Oh, wait, sorry. This is east. My bad. Not central. This,
no.
This is east. Brookstream. Top half of the east.
Top half of the east. So
Brookstream.
Who's in the top right now? Boston,
Pittsburgh, Washington, New York Islanders.
Oh, yeah.
Hartel.
Nope. Brookstream.
Hard.
Backstrom.
Backstrom, nice.
Oh.
Brookstream, Backstrom.
I could go back and re-guess people, you idiot.
I'm so upset I didn't get that. I have a fucking Nicholas Backstrom jersey, so.
Yeah, I said him earlier. I said all these. God damn it.
All right. Okay, so 2-2, 2-2-0.
No, Mike has three, I thought.
You have three?
I do have three.
Oh, you won. All right. Who are you? Oh, Line A.
Line A, Backstrom, and the first one. Natchez.
That's right. Good call. All right. Well, congratulations, Mike. Winner of the
winner. Get that chicken dinner.
Yes. Chicken dinner. Literal last name.
Natchez is a hard one.
Yeah.
This is hard. I like it. It's hard.
We're not doing
anything. What it ended up being just throwing out all the names like of positions at that thing. Although Backstrom was like maybe the only one that I could have gotten because
it's doing it again because I'm out of names. So maybe next time we'll go back to name Pafloon. It's been a minute since we did that.
I like that one. That's been my favorite game so far.
Yeah. So all right. Anything you guys want to talk about? Kevin, thanks for hopping on. Any last words you wanna?
Is this the last Talknutt for the season, you think, or?
Oh, no.
Oh, no way.
No? There'll be a playoff Talknutt?
We'll have a pre-playoff one for sure.
Awesome. Well, I appreciate being on. I'd love to be on again in the future. Enjoying the season. Sure. And good luck to everybody. We finish up here. We got, what, 2 weeks
left? Keep it up.
Two weeks left.
Yep. Kevin's team is making a run, so.
Oh, I do have one last question I want to ask you guys. Why? How am I in third, but I've scored, like, the sixth most points? Like, does that make any sense?
Don't question it. Just let it happen.
Okay.
I mean, just luck sometimes, you know, some weeks you get lucky. We had this, we Mike on the other hand has had the most points against him this year.
An insane amount. Not this year. Every damn year it happens.
It does seem to happen almost every
year. It kind of does happen a lot. I
mean, I'm winning. I'm not upset about it, but I'm like, man, I don't feel like I've had that many close games. Like I've blown the people out I played, but yeah, whatever. Not upset. So, looking forward to listening to this. Looking forward to seeing the Bitmoji. I'm pretty pumped. Tell the producer I said hats off.
Oh, yeah.
Producer is hard at work right now crafting the
to all the people behind the scenes in the Talknutt, I appreciate you. And looking forward to listening to this puppy on live, right?
What about the people in front of the scenes? Do you not appreciate us?
Wow.
Yes, sir.
Say goodbye to your chances of coming on again. Okay.
Whatever the opposite of elitist is, that's what you are.
I didn't think I had to
say that. You're a humblest.
No, thanks. We appreciate it. Thanks for coming on, Kevin.
Yeah, get the hell out of here. Yeah. Now, this is awesome. Looking forward to listening. You guys take care, right?
Later.
All right. Go Razorbacks.
Go Blue Jays.
Guys.
All right. See you guys. And we danced all night to the best podcast ever. We knew every line. Now I can't remember how it goes, but I know that I won't forget her, 'cause we danced all night to the best podcast ever.